We're celebrating Mark Goodson's birthday with special episodes of To Tell the Truth. Happy birthday, Mr. Goodson.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's To Tell the Truth. And here sitting in for Gary Moore is your host for today, Bill Cullen.
Hi there. Thank you. Thank you all very kindly. Hang up there. Thank you. That's enough. Hang on. Oh, that's good. Hey, that's good. I'll tell you why. Thank you for whatever that was for me. But we got a lot of interesting people coming out and save some for the other four little people on the show. They're a grand. Hi, I'm here keeping the seat warm for Gary Moore for a while. He's having some fun. We'll meet our first guest in just a moment. And he has, and listen to this because there's a clue in here, cleverly contrived. The first man we're going to meet later on has a large mission in life. Oh, that's clever. Remember that. But first, let's meet our panel here on To Tell the Truth. That's a beautiful panel, but it's not as pretty as when I was here. No, I say that.
I think you look very pretty there.
Thank you, Kitty. It's you. Durward, I'm happy to see you again, and I'm very pleased that you can be with us. Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you, Bill. My pleasure, indeed.
It is
nice to see you.
Right.
I haven't grown since I saw you last.
You're still taller than I am, though.
Am I really?
Fortunately, you have a bad leg. But that's another story. I can't tell you, Peggy, how nice it is to see you.
I just saw you yesterday.
I know, but it's fun again to see you, Peggy. I mean that sincerely. I'm banking on you to pull me out of this, Peg.
Gee whiz.
And, Kitty, I can't tell you how nice it is to see you.
You seem to be stalling, dear boy.
No, I just want you to know it's real nice to see you. It's a pleasure to have you here.
Thank you very much.
Right, okay, what? Oh, hi, Mark.
Hello, Bill. Nice to be here, Bill.
Yeah, see, he knows he's talking to somebody with seniority in his outfit. If you're not careful, it's both of us back to winner take all.
That's right.
Panel, by way of introducing our first guest, now, this is my first time here, so naturally, they changed everything up. So, to meet our first guest, let's meet his wife. This is Mrs. Fabrey, Joyce Fabrey, right?
Right.
That's Panel, P-A-N-E-L.
Hello.
Hi.
Hello.
Panel, that's Miss Fabrey. Now, Miss Fabrey, if I may, well, let me see how I can put this. You've already put it so well yourself. As Orson Bean would say, you have been bountifully endowed by our creator, Mrs. Fabrey. Would that by any chance have anything to do with his first spot?
Yes, it would.
It would?
Yes.
All right, we'll see how it comes out. Now, since Mrs. Fabrey is here, I'm going to let her, you're in trouble, Johnny, I'm going to let her do Johnny Olson's job and introduce her husband to us. Miss Fabrey, if you will, please. Thank you, ma'am.
What is your name, please?
My name is Bill Fabrey.
And what is your name, please?
My name is Bill Fabrey.
And what is your name, please?
My name is Bill Fabrey.
And thank you, Mrs. Fabrey. You may go backstage now and watch the old man on the monitor, and we'll see you again in just a few minutes. Okay, panel, if you care to hear this, I will now read Bill Fabry's story. I, Bill Fabrey, firmly and positively believe that fat can be beautiful. Throughout the United States, fat people are ridiculed, maligned, and misunderstood. In contrast, the pleasingly plump are appreciated, prized, and admired almost everywhere else, including Eastern Europe, all of the Arab countries, and in many islands of the South Seas. Here in America, the underfed twiggy look is publicized and promoted to such an extent that perfectly healthy women starve themselves into feverish conditions of jangled nerves and bad temper. In order to improve the sad lot of all beautiful fat people, I have founded a new organization called the National Association to Aid Fat Americans. Signed, Bill Fabrey. Thank you. You see what I meant before about a large mission in life? All right. Okay. Panel, this gives you an opportunity for food for thought. They're getting better. Well, we listen to a few messages.
Whatever happened to Stop It? Patented in 1941, Stop It antiperspirant sponsored What's My Line for 8 years. In 56, Stop It inventor Jules Montagnier made a mystery guest appearance on the show. No sweat.
Okay, panel. Remember, these three gentlemen all claim to be Bill Fabrey, founder of the National Association to Aid Fat Americans. And we'll start the questioning with Slim and lovely Peggy Cass.
Thank you. Number two, are you going to aid them to become thin or just to stay fat?
It's a personal preference. We care for everybody to do what he wishes.
Thank you. Well, number three, do you think being fat is healthy?
It is in some cases, and it is not in some cases.
Well, I mean, maybe if you're thin, you have jangled nerves, but if you're too fat, you get heart trouble. So what's the better?
Some people have heart trouble and some people don't have heart trouble.
Well, that's true enough. Now, number one, in the Arab countries and the Eastern European countries, it might be good to be fat, but that's because it's an economic accomplishment because they don't have enough to eat. So, I mean, I don't think that's such a great thing to do. I mean, in New York, we've got plenty to eat. It's nice to be thin.
Well,
we have a question and answer it.
I think what you're saying is we feel that fat people are indirectly discriminated against.
Oh, I don't discriminate against the sales.
You mentioned economic accomplishment, Peggy. Mark, you take up from there.
Thank you. Number two, is it all right to use the word fat, I assume, but since that doesn't insult anybody.
No.
Have you always liked fat girls?
Yes, I have.
Number one, have you always liked them?
Crazy about them.
Back in school?
Oh, yes.
Number three, where did you meet your wife?
At Ithaca College.
Was she heavy then, or did you fatten her up?
No, she was the same weight then.
I see. Number two, why do you think that we have such a cult or an ideal of thin women here? Somebody once said you can never be too thin or too rich. Now, why do you think we feel that way about thinness?
Historically, I don't know. It's just, I guess we're trying to be different from the European point of view.
Kitty Carlisle.
Well, number three, you said that fat people were discriminated against. In what way?
Well, I didn't say it, but it's true.
In what way?
They have trouble getting jobs, and they
really?
Have social problems. Oh, yes, certainly.
Oh, thank you. Number two, I'm sorry. number two, is there any criteria in your club or association for what is fat?
No, it's once again, it's a personal point of view. If a person feels as though he's fat, he's fat.
Oh, no matter what he weighs. I get it. Now, number one, we've all lived on the feeling that moderation is the most important thing in life. Don't you think that too fat or too thin is wrong?
Well, it's not a question of moderation that we actually believe that people's natural body weight sometimes can be attributed as being fat. It's not necessarily.
Do you think, number two, not to be personal, that...
Derwood Kirby.
Thank you. Number one, do you believe that they, in the saying that they're inside of every fat person, there's a thin person trying to get out?
Well, I've met a great number of fat people, including my wife, that I feel is their natural personality. I think their body weight is according to their personality.
Number three, I'm somewhat in accord with your organization because I kind of like fat women myself because I think it's much easier to locate them in the dark. But...
Good point.
Would you say that all fat people are happy people?
No, not all of them are happy. Some of them are happy, but they live in a society that makes it hard to be happy.
Number two, is your wife happy?
Yes.
There you are. I'm going to tell your wife what you said, too, Derwin. She would be very happy to hear that. All right, panel, it's time for you to mark your ballots. Vote number one, number two, or number three. Just write them down there and do the best you can. $50 for all wrong answers. And if you all blow it, if it's a wipeout, $500 goes to our panel. Let me see. We'll start with Peggy.
Well, I don't think it's number one. Hmm. Number three is very aggrieved about the problem of fat people, as well he might be. But, you know, number two looks so happy. And if he's that happy to be married to somebody who's a little plump, he'd have that big smile on his face. So I voted for him.
Okay.
See, he's grinning right now.
Mark?
They all could. They all did a beautiful job. To me... number three, who is slightly paler and I think was a thin child, always wanted to compensate for it by having a fat wife, so I voted for number three.
Excellent reasoning, Your Highness. Kitty?
I voted for number three for two reasons. One, He looks very concerned about the problems of fat people, as well he might be. And when Mrs. Fabrey went off, I thought she gave him a very specially kind look.
All right.
Loving look.
Thank you, Kitty. Durward, it's up to you. Last vote.
Thank you, Bill. I go along somewhat with the reasoning that Kitty just gave, but I felt that number three gave some excellent answers, as did number two. However, when it came to Mrs. Fabrey kissing number three, he looked so embarrassed, and number one looked like he was so accustomed to this so that I voted for number one.
Uh-huh. Well, let's see. Well, they're spread out pretty good. One for one, one for two, and two for three. Okay, panel, the votes are all in now. It's time to find out which of these fine fellas is really Bill Fabrey. And who better to pick out Bill Fabrey, of course, than the lady who introduced all three of them in the first place, Mrs. Fabrey. So if you'll please come back out, ma'am, and show us, there you are, which one of those is it. You never can tell till the very end here. Yes? Let me see. Is it? Oh. Pretty good. Let's take care and find out who our imposters are. Number one, sir, who are you, please, and what do you do?
I'm Warren McGoldrick. I'm a tennis pro and instructor in management training for the Chase Manhattan Bank.
And thank you. Got a vote. Number two.
My name is Hank Rose, and I run the New York Flea Market.
Say, Bill and Joyce, where is your organization located?
It's in Westbury, New York, at Box 745.
Uh-huh. What do you think is the greatest single problem a fat person has to face, Joyce?
Well, it's really personal. Sometimes the social problem is the greatest, and frequently it's the clothing problem that's greater.
Uh-huh. Thank you very much, Mr. and Mrs. Fabrey, and imposters for playing to tell the truth. Okay, by way of introducing our next guest, I'd like to show you a picture of half of her. Here you are. Now, all you tennis buffs will, I'm sure, tennis buffs and lingerie fanciers will recognize those panties as belonging to Gussie Moran. Happily, we'll meet all of Gussie in a moment after a few nicely laced messages.
Time to meet us on the BUZZR Casino floor for Super Password. Bert Convy plays pit boss. Pass lines are tossed. Will players come out winners? Super Password. Starting Monday at 10 p.m. on BUZZR Casino.
Happy BUZZR birthday to game show pioneer Mark Goodson.
As we used to say at South High School at 10th and Carson Street, let's meet our chick style setter.
Number one, what is your name, please?
My name is Gussie Moran.
Number two.
My name is Gussie Moran.
Number three.
My name is Gussie Moran.
Okay. Let me do some reading for you now. I, Gussie Moran, love to bring style to the tennis court. Although I was the fourth ranking women's player in the country and have won the women's indoor and hardcore tennis championships, people undeniably remember me best for my tennis skirt with matching lace panties. Currently, I'm helping to introduce some new tennis fashions. They are equally eye-catching, if not controversial. They're called tennis girl dresses, styled by the famous designer Olga. Number three is in top form in a squared neck bodice dress, which features a long waistline accented with red, white, and blue buttons. Number two is decked out in the smart sailor style dress. It has a twin pleated skirt, relaxed waistline, and a smart sailor type collar with navy trim and tie. Number one also wears the squared neck tennis girl dress, which affords the wearer a new braless freedom, as well as providing a flattering look. Tennis, anyone? Signed, Gussie Moran. Okay, all three of these pretty girls claim to be Gussie Moran. We will start the questioning with a man who's had a great racket for a long time. Mark? Take it away.
I don't know too much about tennis. Let's see if I know anything about lace panties. Gussie number two. When did you begin this? Let's go back in history. When did you start the business of wearing lace panties?
49 in Wimbledon.
49?
Mm-hmm.
You don't look that old. Number one, why did you start? Why lace panties?
Teddy Tingling designed my tennis dress and forgot the pants.
I didn't hear you.
Teddy Tingling designed my tennis dress and forgot the pants. It was a last minute makeup.
So what did you do instead? Forgot the pants?
Yes.
So what did you do instead?
He designed pants in a day and put a half-inch lace around the legs.
Number three, how long did you continue to wear lace panties in your tennis playing?
Oh, all of my life.
Really? Why did you continue with that idea? What was so titillating about lace panties?
I dig them.
You dig them?
So does Mark. Okay, Kitty, can you get us out of panties and into tennis?
No, it fascinates me. Well, I'll try.
All right, with me.
Well, it's very hard to concentrate on anything except the lace on the pants. Number three, I have to ask you one question. Did you know when you wore these lace panties at Wimbledon that it was going to create such a tremendous furore?
No.
Number two, do you know who Suzanne Langlois was?
Yes, she was a very famous tennis player.
Number one, is Olga the lady that makes the lingerie that you're designing for
yes.
now? And number three, how much do your tennis dresses sell for?
Well, they're about the same price as any tennis dress, $35. And I believe this is a $30 model.
Number two, do you still play tennis?
Oh, yes.
Where?
In California.
Oh, you live in California?
Yes.
And number three, are you married?
I'm number three.
I'm sorry, I'm looking at number one. I'm so concerned about the pants. I want to ask you, are you wearing lace pants
not
now?
Not at the moment, I'm not married.
And are you wearing lace
well,
pants?
Yes. Who'd you ask that of? One? Yeah, answer
no,
that, please.
I'm not wearing lace pants.
Not wearing them. Behind every tennis player, there's an Olga and a baseline official. Durward?
I'll get away from your pants for a while, but then we'll get back to it. Number one, I have been told that you're a very tall girl, aren't you? How tall are you?
5'7½".
Which is rather tall, right?
Yes.
And that is a big asset in playing tennis?
Definitely for my serve.
Mm-hmm. And number two, you're not quite that tall.
5'3".
And how about your serve?
No problems at all.
And number three?
I'm 5'8".
Number two, Bill mentioned that you were wearing a sailor-type costume, and I noticed that you have quite a long tie. In playing the game, doesn't that tie get in the way of your racket?
Not at all.
No.
No.
Do you remove the tie?
No, never. So attractive, why should I?
Okay, Durward, Peggy.
Thank you. Number three, a lady tennis player recently said that the purses for ladies in tennis weren't big enough. Who is that?
Billie Jean Moffat King.
Thank you. Number one, what time of the year was Wimbledon held, the Wimbledon Championships?
Just a couple of months prior to Forest Hills. A month prior.
Well, I mean, like what month?
August.
Thank you. And number three, when is Forest Hills?
Right now.
Thank you. And number two, how were you seeded at Wimbledon?
Pardon me?
How were you seeded? What number?
Number five.
You were seeded fifth?
Mm-hmm.
Thank you. And number three, who was the first tennis player, lady tennis player, that wore a big thing around her head, like the hippies wear?
I think you mean Suzanne Langlois, but it wasn't a hippie look. It was more of a bandeau effect.
Thank you. Number two, at Longwood Cricket Club, what kind of courts do they have?
Clay.
Thank you.
Pretty good. Peggy, you know your tennis. Okay, the votes are in. Panel, mark your ballots for number one, number two, or number three. Here, Mark, I see that you're ready to move.
Bill, I think that I have a feeling that I've met Gussie Moran many years ago. I know I've seen her play tennis. I remember her lace panties very well. And so therefore, I think that just on the chance that I have picked her, I'm going to disqualify myself.
I have a feeling you might have too, and I think I know where it might have been. Kitty.
Well, they all are marvelous. Peggy's questions were very searching, and they certainly knew their tennis. But I voted for number two. I liked the way she stood, and I liked the way she answered, and I liked her smile.
Thank you, Kitty. Durward?
I'm inclined to go along with number one. However, from all I've read about this great professional, I think that she was rather undersized, and therefore was quite adept at the game, and therefore I voted for number two.
And Peggy.
I goofed. It wasn't Billie Jean King who said that number three. It was Rosemary Casals.
I knew that.
And Longwood has grass courts.
And
I think I voted for three. I voted for three, but I guess it's two.
Okay, what do we have? We have two for two, one for three, and Mark generously.
Wouldn't it be funny if I disqualified myself for the wrong person, too?
Well, I've been on the show as a panelist for about a year, and I've done it a couple of times, Mark. So there, even the great ones do it. Don't let it worry you. Will the real Gussie Moran please stand up? There she is. You all right? Yeah. Thank you, Gussie. Number one, would you tell us who you are and what do you do, please?
My name is Geoffrey Boyd, and I design computerized typesetting.
Number two?
My name is Dolores Meehan, and I'm a housewife and mother from Manhasset, and I never played tennis in my life.
Well, you did well. You did well. You did very well. Hey, Gussie, in addition to representing Olga, are you anyone else's representative at the moment?
Well, yes, I am. I work for Eastman Chemical in the Codell division, and I also am a representative for Seamless Racket.
Uh-huh.
It doesn't mean they have no seams. I mean, that's the trade name.
You know, I've known you for a long time. What is Gussie? What's your real first name?
Well, Gussie comes from Augusta, my middle name.
Uh-huh.
My first name is Gertrude.
Gertrude, I'd rather see Gussie than Gertie wearing lace panties. Thank you, Gertie, Gussie, and our imposters for playing to tell the truth.
In addition to the cash awards, our first team of challengers will receive for the lady in his life a sparkling rhinestone bracelet, earrings, and pin set designed by Sarah Coventry called Leading Lady. Evening Elegance by Sarah Coventry. Our second team will receive the Caress from Carousel, a marvelous wash and wear mod acrylic stretch wig styled with a natural part tapered back and sides. Carousel offers 26 colors.
You're watching BUZZR's Mark Goodson birthday special episodes of To Tell the Truth, and more birthday fun is on its way. Stay tuned.
Hey, thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you, Bill. Marvelous job, old boy.
Oh, really?
Excellent.
Remember that, sir, when race time comes around. No, thanks, Mark. And Derwood, you've been a great help.
I think they ought to give somebody else a chance.
Yeah, I do, too. Now
the women.
Ladies and gentlemen, this economic discussion will continue tomorrow. Thank you and goodbye from whatever it is.
Promotional consideration provided by American Airlines. Traveling on business and traveling for fun, it's good to know you're on American Airlines. This is Johnny Olson speaking for To Tell the Truth, the Mark Goodson, Bill Todman production. Gentlemen, it's To Tell the Truth, and here sitting in for Gary Moore is your host for today, Bill Collins.
Oh, that's good. Thank you. Thank you. That's all right. First time I ever saw a loaf of bread get applause. Thank you all. I know I'm not supposed to talk with my mouth full, but actually, I'm doing my job. You see, this delicious pumpernickel bread was provided by our first... He provided a fly, too. Was provided by our first guest today. We'll meet him in a minute as he tries to fool you and our panel here on To Tell the Truth.
And Kitty Carlisle.
Oh, look. That's for me.
I'm on a diet.
Wait, you're not now. You do what you're told on this show. Everybody on this show does what they're told. And hi, Dirk. Good to have you all back again.
Thanks for bringing lunch in.
That's all right. And Peggy.
Hiya, how are you?
I wasn't kind to you yesterday, Mark. I know that.
You were very nice. You were very good.
Oh, good. I'll do
Thank
the same
you.
Bit.
Thank you for the bagel.
Same bit today, then. Short shrift for our packager. And Kitty, happy to have you.
Thank you.
Okay. That was a funny noise you made. Say that again.
It's my electronic, yes.
What is this? I thought I did a great job on yesterday's show. I called my wife. I told her, swell. And here on the desk, it says, Peggy replaces Bill as MC.
That's right, and I don't want you to feel badly. It's only a temporary arrangement.
I feel badly.
Well, I know, but you were fair only. Oh. The first guest on the show is a gentleman I know very well, so I get to be the MC.
Right.
And since you don't know him, you get to ask the questions and vote.
Oh, and I can eat bread, too.
Yeah, so let's switch places and get on with the game.
Right. Oh, good. I'm glad finally we've got a lady.
Women's liberation.
We've got a woman on the show. Hooray! Bravo to our side.
Isn't this the biggest loaf of bread you ever saw in your whole life?
Yeah.
Okay, let's meet my friend, the man who brought us these delicious bagels and pumpernickel.
Number one, what is your name, please?
My name is High Lippstein.
Number two.
My name is High Lippstein.
Number three.
My name is I Lippstein.
Now let me read High Lippstein's story. I, High Lippstein, am known as the Bagel King. I distribute delicious bagels, bialys, rye, and pumpernickel bread to New York's finest restaurants and nightclubs. While making my nocturnal rounds, I frequently meet Broadway and television stars, famous movie actors, and sports personalities. I have discovered that the one thing these famous people have in common is this: they love bagels. When I offer them the gift of a bag of bagels, beautiful ladies kiss me, and strong men beam with delight. I usually ask them if they would mind if I took a snapshot of them with me and my bagels. As a result, the inside of my delivery truck is filled with pictures of such luminaries as Lauren Bacall, Duke Ellington, and Zsa Zsa Gabor. One of my favorite bagel mavens is here today to tell the truth, delightful Peggy Cass. All right, panel, all three gentlemen claim to be my friend, High Lippstein, the Bagel King. Let's start the questioning with...
there's
a commercial first. Huh? Oh, nuts.
It was 1941, and America was about to meet the TV game show.
Oh, bless you.
BUZZR invites you to celebrate 75 years of TV's greatest game shows.
Boy, oh boy.
From fashion fads to newsmakers.
Oh, yeah.
Movers and shakers.
That's amazing, isn't it?
Plus, rare shows, special surprises, and all the games you know and love.
Yes, sir.
Come celebrate with us all year long, only on BUZZR. Let's play.
I'll be there, I swear.
All right, panel. All three gentlemen claim to be my friend, High Lippstein, the Bagel King. Let's start the questioning with our former MC, Bill Cullen.
Peggy, I want you to know, in all my many years, no one has ever done as much for my confidence as you have right now. And I mean that in the sweetest possible way. Hey, number one, there was... This past summer, there was a story. Zsa Zsa Gabor was robbed of all her many sparkling things, and you took her. Is this true? Are you the person who took the bagels up to Zsa Zsa's place, number one?
Yes.
You were the one who went up there?
Yes.
Number three, don't you think that's sort of dangerous, going up to Zsa Zsa's place right after everyone stole all her rings?
No, this was before.
Oh, you didn't go up after?
After I gave her another bag, but this was before. The first time I met her, I gave her a bag of bagels.
I see. Number two, I read it. Wait a minute. Number three...
So the first time I met, I gave a bag of bagels
and
gave her a kiss. She likes bagels.
A bag of bagels.
All right. When was the first time, number three, that you gave Zsa Zsa a bag of bagels?
I met her in one of the nightclubs. I went over, I said, Mrs. Gabor, here's a bag of bagels. She's for me? I said, yes. Then I asked if I can take a picture with her with me, so I gave somebody the camera and took the picture.
I vote for number three.
back.
I think it's fantastic. They're also marveled. Number two, will you say for me a bag of bagels?
A bag of bagels.
Number one, would you say a bag of bagels?
A bag of bagels.
Number three?
A bag of bagels.
That's marvelous. Number two, I'm really... What actually is a bagel? What is a bagel?
What is a bagel? That's like asking, what is heaven?
Number three, how do you...
A bagel comes from the Yiddish word, to bagen. You know, you bake, you twist something, you bake it, so that's what's a bagel.
I understand.
That's how they call
it. Well, how do you make a bagel? Why is a bagel different from this other thing here?
First, you put the bagel in cold water.
Yes. See?
And then you take it out and you put it in the oven.
Yes.
And it gets the brown part there. Uh-huh. And it's very hard. Don't eat it when it's hot.
You should make a record.
Wonderfully informative, and now we go on to Miss Bagel herself, Kitty Carlisle.
I want to thank the management for striking a blow for ladies. We finally have a woman moderator. Thank you. Number two, how come you get to meet the customers?
Well, you know, you got to be a little sneaky in this business.
Thank you. Number two, do you go from the back door right into the front door with your bag of bagels? Number one, I mean.
No, right?
When you deliver the bagels, you deliver them to the kitchen, right?
No, it all depends. Sometimes to the front door, sometimes to the kitchen.
Well, how come you get into the front door?
Well, I bribe the doorman.
Aha. Uh-huh. Number three, how much do you have to pay him?
Yeah, I got to tell this.
Yeah. You can lie if
you want. It's according to what he wants, but I don't pay him nothing. I give him a bag of bagels, he's satisfied.
Now to Mr. Kirby.
Thank you. Number three, it says here in the affidavit, you're the bagel king. Who crowned you king?
I crowned myself king. I don't make it.
Thank you. Number two, what is a bialy? Is that the way you pronounce it?
A bialy.
Yes.
A bialy originated in a place called Bialystok, which used to be part of Poland, then became part of Russia. Now, originally, the thing came about this way. In ancient history, at that time, there was the Tartars. And these Tartars, see, they'd have the grandfather. And this grandfather used to, when they'd have a marriage, he'd knock out the front tooth of the son-in-law. But they had to figure out a different way because they had a lot of toothless Tartars walking
Shut
around.
Shut up, will you?
And now, panel, it's time to vote on this very important question. And we must vote for number one, or for number two, or for number three. We pay $50 for each wrong vote and $500 if the panel is stumped completely. Bill, you start the voting.
I don't want to.
Go ahead.
Well, it's simple. Number two and number three are actors. And if they're not, they should be actors. And I voted for that reason for number one. He looks like a nice, gentle fellow.
Okay, Mark?
If number three really is the fella, it's incredible because he's one of the funniest men I've ever heard, and number two also. I think number one spends more of his time with bagels and less with comedy, so I vote for him.
Kitty? Well, I think the other two are marvelous, and I think number three probably has enough chutzpah to do what he said he did.
Chutzpah's like a bagel. Yes.
But I voted for number one because I think he's the real baker.
Derwood?
Number three completely fascinated me. Number one is probably the real man, although he didn't seem too interested in this whole thing. But I had to vote for number two because it's the longest playing record I ever heard in my life.
Okay, the votes are all in. As you know, I am the MC of this show because I know Hi very well, and I can prove it. I have a picture of Hi with me, so take a look and see if you recognize him. Back to you in a minute. But first, let's find out who our imposters are. Number two, you got one vote. What's your name and what do you really do?
My real name is Jack Weinstein, and right now I'm working as a guard for Mandel Securities at the detective agency.
I bet they sleep safe. Number three, you didn't get any votes, but I'd give you a big kiss.
Oh, what, my granddaughters are right there.
What's your real name?
My name is Harrison C. Wrestler. I'm a salesman for New York Trim and Fashion at 241 West 36th Street.
Hi, number one, the real hi. Who's the greatest bagel fancy of all your celebrity friends? The one who likes bagels the most, the real bagel person of all the people you know. Well, we'll go on to another question. thank you very much.
Jackie Vernon.
Jackie Vernon.
Yes.
Okay, he's lost a lot of weight. He must be laying off the bagels.
70 lately. Pounds.
Okay, I want to thank you all very much. It's wonderful to give me my first opportunity to be an MC, and I love your bagels and your Moshe Pumpernickel and everything about you. Goodbye. Hey, Bill, should I read the next thing?
Yeah, go ahead.
Our next guest is over 21 some of the time, and at other times she isn't. I'd like to know her secret. We'll meet this interesting woman in a moment as TTT, to tell the truth, moves on.
This week in game show history, Mark Goodson is born. Goodson works in a fish market before producing his first radio game show called Pop the Balloon. He and Bill Todman create over 40 hit shows, including Family Feud and Match Game, and in 90 wins the Lifetime Achievement Emmy Award.
Oh, that was a funny bit. Funny bit, Peggy.
Yes, I like doing that.
Oh, you do?
Yes.
Good, well, stick with it. When you're my age, it might be a little help for you. That was Peggy Cass filling in for me, and I'm filling in for Gary Moore, and on the panel is Mark Goodson, who is filling in for me, since I'm here filling in for Gary, and Derwood Kirby, who's filling in for Orson, who's on a leave of absence. If there are any questions, just address your letter to
what
someone else.
Huh? What am I?
You're your own sweet self.
Oh, you
fill in beautifully. You're all right. Let's meet the woman that Peggy was talking about, who is never far from 21.
Number one, what is your name, please?
My name is Jean Brady.
Number two.
My name is Jean Brady.
Number three.
My name is Jean Brady.
Okay, here's Jean Brady's story panel, so if you will, listen carefully. I, Jean Brady, am a blackjack or 21 dealer. I'm the first and only woman to deal cards at a major casino on the Las Vegas Strip in over 30 years. Thanks to a ruling by the State Labor Commission, I am now working at Howard Hughes' glittering Silver Slipper. Actually, I was employed there as a slot machine cashier when the manager asked me if I'd like to deal blackjack. I turned the new job down at first, but accepted when asked a second time. It's pleasant work, the pay is good, and don't underestimate me, I can handle card sharks with the best of them. Signed, Gene Brady. As Kitty Carlisle says, I'm a man who will read anything. I will prove that. Let's start the questioning with a man who is quite a card himself. Derwood Kirby. Oh, sorry about
that. You do have intestinal fortitude,
yes.
I'll tell you that.
No, it's just cold in my head.
Contestant number one, please. How long have you been dealing?
Well, I was dealing before Las Vegas for about 5 years.
And where was that?
In North Las Vegas, in Jerry's Nugget.
And where had you dealt before, number three?
Harold's Club in Reno.
And you, number two?
Well, I dealt in Reno and North Las Vegas and Henderson.
Number two, who taught you how to deal?
Well, when I learned to deal, they put me with another dealer, and the other dealer taught me.
Number three, is that the way you learned?
My father taught me how to deal.
Oh, your daddy taught you, huh? What makes a card shark, number one, and how would I detect one?
Well, a card shark is someone who plays high stakes and watches everybody else's hands very closely to know all the cards that are out.
Okay, and a lady now who used to be an MC, Peggy Katz.
Thank you. Number three, what must the dealer stand on?
17.
Okay, number two, the dealer must hit if he has 16?
Right.
Okay. Number one, what's insurance?
Insurance is when the dealer shows an ace. She offers the players the opportunity to bet on
that. Number three, who's the comic at the Silver Slipper?
Right now, we don't. We have Barry Ashton's Wonderful World of Burlesque. The comic changes every week, and I've been away for a week.
Are you number two? Who's Hank Henry?
He's a comedian.
Thank you. Number one, what does blackjack pay off? What's the payoff on blackjack?
It's 1.5 if you have it on a natural.
Thank you. Number two, do you believe in splitting tens?
At times.
Well, I mean, what would your advice be?
Okay, that brings us to you, Mark.
I can see that Peggy not only knows about bagels.
She does. You're right.
Okay. Where is the, number two, where is the Silver Slipper located in Las Vegas?
Well, it's about the middle of the strip.
Number one, you know about other gambling games, too. What is the number that you try for in Chemin de Fer?
Well, I'm not familiar with the other games, really.
I see. Number three, what is the number you try for in Chemin de Fer?
I'm a dealer. I don't play any of the other games.
You don't play. What is, number two, what is doubling down mean?
Well, you get one card face down. Usually people double on a 9 or 10.
I see. Number three, where in Las Vegas does Don Rickles generally play?
Where is it? At the Sands? I'm not real sure, to tell you the truth.
Mm-hmm. Number one, are you the only lady dealer in Las Vegas?
Yes.
There's never been one?
Okay, ends up with you,
I'm
Kitty.
I'm fascinated. Number two, why did you turn it down the first time?
Well, I was a little reluctant about the publicity that would follow.
Why was that?
Because I'm shy.
Number one, was it the money that urged you to do it, that finally decided you?
Yes, it was.
Number two, it was the money. Number one, do you get tips from satisfied customers who win?
Well, we don't really discuss the tips. We get them occasionally.
And you pocket them. Number three, can you tell me about card sharks? Now, not sharks, really, but cheats. Is there anything that you can look for that you can discover inside? Can one cheat at blackjack?
That's, I suppose so. Yeah, that isn't my job. Usually a pitman or something will watch for that.
Thank you. Number two, can you...
And that just about does it. Thank you, Kitty. It's time to vote now, panel. Vote for number one, number two, or number three. And, Durward, you started the questioning. You may...
Yes, thank you, Bill.
Number there.
I thought they were all very good. I'm not going to go for number one because I... one question she hesitated quite a mm-hmm. little bit on. She had to decide within her own mind. Number two was also very good. I think she knows the game, but I don't think she's the real dealer. And I think number three is the one we're looking for.
All right. Peggy?
No, Hank Henry is so synonymous with the Silver Slipper that I thought that they should know that. And number two, that number one and three should have known that it's a natural 8 or 9 for Chemin de Fer, I think, if they live at a place where they gamble all that much. So I voted for number the shy one, number two. I'll play your table
Mark.
If we ever get there.
Yeah, well, they were all very good, and the reason that I am voting for number two is because, for the reason Peggy mentioned, neither one nor three knew about Chemin de Fer. Even if they were dealers in some other game, they should have known that.
And...
Well, number one is definitely shy and could easily be the real one. Number three, I think, is more junior league than blackjack. And I think number two is really shy and knows her business, and I voted for her.
Okay, we have 0 for 1, 3 for number two. Number three has one vote. Will the real Jean Brady please stand up?
It's...
Oh. Ah!
Okay, we'll find out who our imposters are. Number one, please, ma'am, your name and what do you do?
Yes, I'm Ray Wilder. I run the Appalachian Enterprise Craft Shop at 88 Park Avenue in Bayshore.
Thank you. And number three, suppose you tell us who you are and what you do, please.
I'm Beryl Bender, and I design acrylic or plexiglass furniture and sculpture.
And you
never played blackjack, but I'm going to.
You've all done a real good job. Thank you, Jean Brady and Imposters, for being with us to play To Tell the Truth.
In addition to the cash awards, our first team of challengers will receive this magnificent cufflink and tie-tack set by Anson, crowned with Lindy Stars, the man-made jewels that rival nature's costliest gems. Our second team will receive a sparkling rhinestone bracelet, earrings, and pin set designed by Sarah Coventry called Leading Lady, Evening Elegance by Sarah Coventry.
You're watching BUZZR's Mark Goodson birthday special episodes of To Tell the Truth, and more birthday fun is on its way. Stay tuned.
Hey, you know something, Peggy?
What?
The funniest single spot since I've been on this show, that's so a year, a little over a year, was the bagel spot. Your friend and your emceeing. I don't know if that means anything about you're an MC, but that was the funniest spot. So there.
It was wonderful.
I forgot to ask, by the way, somebody, it says a bagel maven. What is a maven?
A maven is a person who's a...
A fan?
Yes.
You know how you say maven in English?
Marvin.
Goodbye.
Promotional consideration provided by American Airlines. Traveling on business or traveling for fun, it's good to know you're on American Airlines. Hotel accommodations courtesy of Delmonico's Hotel on fashionable Park Avenue, ideal for gracious living. Visit famous Delmonico's restaurant for superb continental cuisine. This is Johnny Olson speaking for To Tell the Truth, the Mark Goodson, Bill Todman production.
Welcome to Tell the Truth. Thank you, John, and very nice people. Hey, our first guest today is the manager of a place that boasts, and I read from the mug here, "We were here before you were born. That's what it says. In addition, they also say, here's the other one, it says on here, good ale, raw onions, and no ladies. Well, one-third of that claim has gone by the boards, and we'll find out more about this right after we meet our panel here on To Tell the Truth.
Derwin Kirby. Peggy Cash. Mark Goodson. And Kitty Carlisle.
Did you like that?
My
German father-in-law taught me how to do that.
That's very elegant.
He also taught me how to drink, for obvious reasons. Not me. Anyway, panel, I'd like you to take, if you watch your monitor down there, everybody can see it, I hope. I want you to take a look at a very recent photograph. There. Do you recognize any of those faces? Look closely.
Yes.
Yeah, you do?
No.
I know who
Peggy?
That is.
Who Peggy?
I bet those women libs going into some fella's preserve.
Well, no.
Oh. McSorley's.
You know, they are the young lady from our own To Tell the Truth staff.
Oh, I wish I hadn't said anything.
Yeah. Anyway, they were down there to McSorley's Ale House for light refreshment. Light refreshment. They're not back yet. Anyway, for over a century, McSorley's has refused to admit women. But that, as you all know, is ancient history now. Let's meet the manager of the celebrated saloon.
Number one, what is your name, please?
My name is Daniel O'Connell Kirwin.
Number two.
My name is Daniel O'Connell Kirwin.
Number three.
My name is Daniel O'Connell Kirwin.
Okay, panel, as you know, your job is to find out which one of these three young fellas is Daniel O'Connell Kirwin. Don't you love that name?
Here's his Maldy message. I, Daniel O'Connell Kirwin, am the manager of McSorley's Old Ale House. For 116 years, this famous New York saloon was off limits to women, and in the eyes of many, this was its particular charm and virtue. But now, alas, we have to serve women as well as men. This was the decision handed down by the city council, which outlawed discrimination based on sex in public accommodations. I have mixed feelings about women being permitted to storm our legendary male bastion. For while there is tradition on the one side, there are the waves of change on the other. I should add, however, that in the many years that my family has been associated with McSorley's, none of our women folk ever passed through its doors during working hours. And this included the actual owner of McSorley's, my very own mother. Signed, Daniel O'Connell Kirwin. Okay, while you bend your elbows to write questions, we're going to drink in a few, I'm sorry, a few messages.
Time to meet us on the BUZZR Casino floor for Family Feud. Families take a spin at the top answers, hoping to hit the jackpot.
Survey said.
Family Feud, tonight at 10 on BUZZR Casino. Feeling lucky?
I have a tremendous idea how to strike back in the name of men at women's liberation. I'm going to take home, right after this show, a real McSorley's mug and hit my wife with it. That made a big hit out there. All right, now keep in mind, all three of these fellas claim to be Daniel O'Connell Kirwin, manager of McSorley's Old Ale House. Well, Peggy, I won't say this is your field, but isn't it?
Number two, how did you feel when all those girls marched into your place?
Personally or business-wise? I wasn't there at the time, but I didn't like to see the tradition broken.
Number three, have the male customers fallen off since this terrible event happened?
No, they're still coming in. It's kind of like a show right now.
Do you think that those girls will level off?
I think so. I think it's more a curiosity than anything else.
Yeah. Number one, I don't mean to be indelicate, but do you have a ladies' room?
No, we haven't.
Ha! So, well, they can't stay long, then. Number two, how many kinds of draft ale do you have?
Two.
What are they?
Ale and porter.
And you have porter. Number three, do you serve your Guinnesses cold or warm?
We don't serve Guinness.
Number one, what's your...
You sure have a vast knowledge of many things.
Absolutely incredible.
Right. I can't say the same for you, Mark, but it's your turn.
No. All right. I must say, by the way, these three men look less like bartenders and more like philosophers, each one. Number three, tell me about the day the ladies came.
Well, it was kind of a sad day in one way, that it was the end of a tradition for 116 years and probably the beginning of a sign of the times and change.
Well, did they come in under, they just walk in and burst in? I mean, anybody try to stop them?
Well, until the official time, there were a lot of militant types that were waiting outside to be the first one in.
Militant types? Anybody burn their brassieres?
Not quite.
I'll drink to that.
why was this tradition developed, do you think, of no women?
Well, when McSorley's was opened in 1854, it was unheard of for women to be seen in a public house.
Number one, how many women now have been coming in, would you say, daily?
It's been tapering off. The first few days, there were a lot of people down, a lot of girls down to be shown on television.
Number two, do they drink the same kind of...
Thank you, Mark. Kitty, have you ever been in a saloon?
I don't think so.
Well, go ahead anyway.
Number two, it says here that your mum is the owner. Didn't mum come in to see how you were minding the store when it was closed, even?
When it was closed, yes.
I'll bet she did. Number three, what is porter?
Porter is a beverage made from dried malt. In other words, the malt would be burned a bit more than on ale.
Number one, do you give free lunch?
No.
And number three, were you the one that fought with that first lady who came in? I saw a picture of a great scuffle.
No, I wasn't.
Number two, did you fight with her?
No, indeed.
Number one, who fought with her then? Was it a bartender or a patron?
There were no fights.
There was a... I saw... Well, I thought I saw it.
Thank you, Kitty and Durwood. We end up with you.
Thank you, Bill. Number one, how long, sir, have you been the manager?
For 8 years.
And number three, how long have you been the manager?
8 years.
Number two, did your dear mother teach you your trade?
No, she didn't.
Number one, who taught you?
I grew up with it.
Number three, what does it mean when someone says they're going to rush the growler?
They're going to rush the growler, you mean?
No, rush the growler.
Rush the growler by taking out ale in a growler, is that what you mean?
Yes. Oh, you've been around a long time, haven't you? Would you believe it, number two, if I told you in your 116 years of existence I've never been in your establishment? I regret to report that. Have you ever seen me there?
I never have, no.
No. Number one, have you ever seen me there?
No.
You go there?
Number three, how do you make a martini?
Too late, Derwin.
Too late.
114 years, and I was only in there once to use the ladies' room. They didn't have it.
What's it there?
Thank you, Stanley Sapp. Rush the Growler, Derwin, huh? You go back as far as I do with Rush the Growler. All right, panel, you're going to vote for number one, number two, or number three. $50 for each correct answer. Hey, Peggy.
Well, I don't think it's number two. Number one used a fine alcohol expression called tapering off, but I didn't vote for him. I think the one who's named after the great liberator Daniel O'Connell is number three.
Okay, Mark.
I really have no idea about this. They all look fine, except that I took the Rush the Growler cue from Durward, and I voted for number three as well.
Oh, you go back, too, Kitty.
Well, I voted for number two. He looks like he's firm and could bounce out unruly patrons, and he looks like he has a sense of humor, which you'd need to run that kind of an establishment.
Durward.
Well, I think, Bill, number one looks like a very distinguished gentleman, meaning no offense to you, number two. But when we came to the growler thing, number three really hit it right on the head, so my vote goes for him.
Okay, we have one for two and three for three. Will the real Daniel O'Connell Kirwin please stand up? Number one, sir, you did a fine job and obviously know your way around. Who are you, sir, and what do you do?
My name is Tom Beasy. I'm with Westinghouse Electric International Company as an engineer.
Thank you, sir. Number two? Who are you, sir?
My name is Bob McLeod, and I'm the president of the United States Darting Association.
Happy to have you with. You know, we don't have too much time to talk, but Daniel, I want to ask, what was it that your mother said when someone asked at the 100th McSorley's anniversary why she, as a lady owner, had never entered the premises?
She said that cocktails and sawdust don't mix, and that the ladies prefer cocktails, and that the sawdust should be left to the boys in the back room.
Your mother is a fine broth of a lady, sir. Thank you all very much for being with us on the television. Our next guest is a young man who has whirled and twirled his way into a national championship. We'll meet him in just a moment as our program rolls along. It's getting worse. All right, let's meet our youthful champion.
Number one, what is your name, please?
My name is Ricky Lowe.
Number two.
My name is Ricky Lowe.
Number three.
My name is Ricky Lowe.
All right, here's Ricky Lowe's statement, and wait till you hear, panel. Listen carefully, if you will. I, Ricky Lowe, am the national hula hoop champion. As I revolved and rotated with rhythm and gusto, my whirling body was encircled by no less than four hula hoops at one time. It was really something to win the title because 750,000 hula hoopers competed. Not in the finals, of course, because by that time, all but 12 kids had been eliminated. I received a beautiful trophy for winning, in addition to a $1,000 bond. However, it was just a simple statistic that gave me the most pleasure. You see, I am the first boy who has ever won. Signed, Ricky Lowe. You notice You notice, panel, how we balanced an otherwise delicate issue there. McSorley's and Hooker. Durwood would be our guest.
Thank you, Bill.
Oh, but you aren't.
Number two, how old are you, Ricky?
I am 12.
Number one, how old are you?
14.
And number three?
13.
You're all very good-looking boys, I'll say that. Now, Ricky, number one, is this an annual event?
Yes.
And number three, you say that you're the first boy to win. How many girls competed against you?
There were nine.
In what area? Here in New York?
Right around the waist.
In California.
Oh, around the waist.
Oh. That's a question.
Number two, you say you twirl. You're getting sick, Bill. Number two, you say you do four of these hoops at one time?
Yes.
I had a very dear friend one time who did this with five and screwed himself 4 feet into the ground. Would you believe that? No, absolutely not.
All right. Peggy, what do you want to do about this?
Number two, where were the contestants from all over the country?
Yes.
And number one, where were the finals held?
In Hollywood, California.
Thank you. Number three, is yours a special hula hoop that you worked on, or is it a plain old ordinary hula hoop?
It's an ordinary one.
You didn't doctor it up at all?
No.
Thank you. Number two, how long did you keep the hula hoop going, the four going for?
For about 2 minutes.
2 minutes. Thank you. Number one, do they count, what are you judged on, grace or length or what?
Grace and originality.
Originality.
Yes.
Number three, where did the hula hoops go on you? One around your waist, two around your arms, or what?
One around my hand, one around my neck, one around my waist, and one around my knees.
Holy cow. That must be very hard to do.
Mark Goodson has a hula hoop in his office. Mark, do you want to continue this?
Sure do. May I, first of all, recapitulate what Durwood said about the fact that you are three very attractive, handsome boys. I think it's marvelous.
Thank you.
Number one, where are you from?
New York.
You're from New York. Number two, where are you from?
I'm from West Palm Beach in Miami.
And
Florida.
Florida. In Miami. Good. Number three, where are you from?
Portland, Oregon.
Let me ask you a question, fellas. You know about this spot and I don't. Is there any likelihood that any members of the panel are going to be called on to whirl these hoops after the spot?
Oh.
You know about that, number three?
Yes.
We are going to be called on to do this?
Yes.
You wanted to be on the show, Mark? There we
are. The reason I ask that is I have a partner called Bill Todman I keep for just these occasions.
Oh, well. Hey, Kitty, would you like to bail us out?
In view of the fact that I just heard something absolutely dreadful, number one, have you ever seen a grown-up do it properly?
Yes.
Uh-oh.
Today.
Number two, what other kinds of original ways that the other people in the contest use the hoops?
Well, they do the wrap the mummy. That's from the neck all the way down.
Oh, I see. Up and down, yes.
And you put two on your arm. One goes one way and the other goes the other way.
Oh, that's very good. Number three, how many girls and how many boys in the finals?
There were nine girls and three boys.
And number two, you come from Miami. Did they pay your way to California?
No, I come from West Palm Beach.
I mean West Palm Beach. Did they pay your way?
No.
Okay. That's it. He just lived in Miami a short time. You're ready to vote. Now you vote for number one, number two, or number three. $50 for every wrong answer. All right, Durward, you got a vote there for us?
Yes, I have, Bill. These boys were all very good, but I'm going to go with number two because just for one thing that he said, I used to be pretty good at what he calls wrap the mummy.
Yeah.
So I'll go, oh, my goodness. My head's
you up. Sort of look like you were good at that, Durward.
I'm such a liar.
Oh. Peggy.
Well, you're all adorable, but
thank
I think
you.
It's Ricky Lowe number three because he said to, that he did one with his hand, and that sounds so professional that I think it's you.
Phil Todman's partner?
Well, I tell you, I'm sort of outthinking the producers because Ricky Lowe would be a Chinese name. They have a Chinese boy, therefore it's probably number one.
Aha! Because he hasn't met Fritz Lowe.
That's right. Well, I voted for number, there could be any of them. I voted for number two absolutely on a hunch, and I just hope to goodness that they don't call on me.
Okay. Let's see, we have one for one, two for two, and one for three. Will the real Ricky Lowe please stand up? Boys do a bit here, you see, a little choreography. Whoa, this is clever. Well, you see this. There, whoops. There. Now watch this, because, boy, there he is.
Very good. Hey, let's quickly, let's meet our imposters who both did a sensational job. Number one, who are you, sir, and what do you do? What do you do? Go ahead.
My name is Kevin Jones, and I'm a recent graduate from St. Clement Pope.
Good for you. Congratulations. Number two, formerly of Miami, now West Palm Beach, number two.
My name is Eric Donahue. I live in New York City, and I go to school at IS-70.
Okay, I'll tell you. All right. Ricky, come on out here. Yes, Mark?
Sign down there.
It says yes. Ricky, come on over. The sign says, Ricky, come on over here to and do your little bit for us. Ricky's going to do a demonstration for you. Come on, Rick. Sign also says, do not interrupt the MC. All right, Ricky Lowe. Hey, panel, so no one will be embarrassed, why don't all of you go on over there? Imposters, you fellas too, go on over there, center stage. I'll keep the dignity of the show over here. Oh, they'll show you there'll be nothing. Go ahead, Kitty. Mark, Durward. Oh, go on, Kitty. I'll stay with you, Kitty. You're lonesome. Not that I can't do it. All right, go ahead. Here we go. Give a little music.
Team of challenges will receive for the lady in his life a sparkling rhinestone bracelet, earrings, and pin set designed by Sarah Coventry called Leading Lady, Evening Elegance by Sarah Coventry. Our second team will receive Holiday Magic High Tide toiletries for men, includes cologne, aftershave, and soap, a special assortment for good grooming for men of every age, all by Holiday Magic.
Up next, families take a lucky shot at guessing the top answers. It's family time on BUZZR Casino on a double play of Family Feud with host Richard Dawson.
Beautiful. Bet you thought I couldn't do it, didn't you?
I'll see ya.
Bye out there.
Promotional consideration provided by American Airlines. Traveling on business and traveling for fun, it's good to know you're on American Airlines. Hotel accommodations courtesy Delmonico's Hotel on Fashionable Park Avenue, ideal for gracious living. Visit famous Delmonico's restaurant for superb continental cuisine. This is Johnny Olson speaking for To Tell the Truth, a Mark Goodson, Bill Todman production.